This is Dr. Robert C. Newman in his Synoptic Gospels course, lecture number 4, on the authorship and date of the Synoptic Gospels.
Good afternoon. We're continuing our Synoptic Gospels course here. We have so far looked at three major topics here. The historical Jesus, the Jewish background, introduction to exegesis and narratives with a sample of the visit of the wise men. And we're ready to go on section 4 now, authorship and date of the Synoptic Gospels. And we will also throw in here at the end characteristics of the Synoptic Gospels as well. We want to here sketch the historical evidence for the Synoptic Gospels being written by their traditional authors, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and all before 70 AD. We suggest that Matthew was written first, also traditional, that the order of Mark and Luke is uncertain. Traditionally, Mark is next, though we favor Luke in the late 50s and Mark in the early 60s, shortly after Matthew was translated into Greek. So, let's go have a look at these things. We'll start with the authorship of the Synoptics and go through each one of those and look first at internal evidence and at external evidence, and then we'll come back and think about the date. So, authorship of the Synoptics, Matthew's authorship. Internal evidence. Well, except for the title, and we, by the way, never have a copy of Matthew with any other person listed in the title. The text is anonymous. That is, the writer never indicates when he is alluding to himself in an identifiable manner. We don't know if the title was put on the autograph by the author or not. If you're familiar with the titles, we'll mention them now and again. They're all, titles on the King James are the Gospel of St. Matthew, Gospel of St. Mark, Gospel according to St. Matthew, Gospel according to St. Mark, etc. The earliest titles we have on papyri are Gospel according to Matthew, according to Mark, according to Luke. And in the earliest parchments, some of those are shortened even to just according to, where Gospel is understood. Well, given that Matthew wrote it, it's interesting that we're still on internal evidence. It's interesting that in his apostle list, Matthew 10, 2 through 4, he calls himself a tax collector, which was not exactly a popular profession in New Testament Palestine. Tax collectors have probably never been super popular with the taxpayers anyway, any time in history. But in the Roman Empire, where you had areas that had been conquered in one way or another, the Palestine at this point had not been too fiercely conquered, but the inhabitants did not appreciate paying taxes to Rome, and the Roman collection method at this point was such that it led to a great deal of corruption and over-collecting and things of that sort, so that the tax collectors were viewed as traitors and crooks and various other sorts of things. The Matthew, Luke, and Acts apostle lists omit this detail about Matthew being a tax collector from the apostle lists anyway. So this perhaps suggests the humility of Matthew, and may also suggest a probable reason for all the Gospels being anonymous, namely to keep the focus on Jesus. That's all we know about internal evidence of the Gospel of Matthew. So consistently the titles of all the Gospels, as we'll see, have these particular names on it, traditional names on it, and no others. External evidence. Well, we've got a fair bit of external evidence, and we're going to walk through that, naming various writers and saying a little bit about them as well. The earliest writer we've got that makes some statement of this sort is a fellow named Papias, and he's writing perhaps around 130 A.D. in his work, The Exposition of the Oracles of the Lord, we have this remark, then Matthew wrote the oracles in the Hebrew dialect, but everyone interpreted them as he was able. The term the oracles is the Greek ta logia, and is rather regularly used for revelations from God. Okay, so a rather strongish term. The Hebrew dialect, the word dialect, there's actually a word we get, our word dialect, from dialecto. There's a possible range of meaning of it, but the Hebrew language is certainly within that range. The original of Papias' exposition, the Oracles of the Lord, is not extant. Extracts of it are cited, extracts from it are cited by several ancient and even medieval authors, and the whole work was apparently still extant in the Middle Ages. Our citation here comes from Eusebius's Church History, so written about 325, give or take a bit, Book 3, Chapter 39, Section 16. So, what's meant here by the oracles? Was this the gospel? Liberals who hold to the two-document theory, we'll look at that later in our discussion, the synoptic problem, often say the oracles were the Q source, and evangelicals have often said the same thing as well. However, Papias later uses oracle to refer to Mark, and everyone agrees that he is referring to the gospel there. Irenaeus gives the same tradition regarding its origin, but explicitly identifies it as the Gospel of Matthew. What's meant by the Hebrew dialect? Okay, this could refer either to Hebrew Aramaic language, as both were sometimes called Hebrew in antiquity. This would imply that the original Matthew was in Hebrew or Aramaic, and that was translated later. In opposition to the above ideas, some take dialect to mean Greek written in a Hebraistic style. This theory does not fit Papias' comment as well, as it is hard to see how a simple stylistic difference would make Matthew so difficult to interpret. The idea of a language foreign to a Greek audience is more in keeping with Papias' remark. Recently, George Howard at the University of Georgia has argued that a rather poorly preserved text of the original Hebrew of Matthew has come down to us in a medieval Jewish polemical anti-Christian text called Evan Bohan, Touchstone. See George Howard's work, The Gospel of Matthew According to a Primitive Hebrew Text, published by Mercer University Press in 1987. Irenaeus is our next author that we hear from in this regard. He's writing about 50 years after Papias, around 180 AD. And in his work Against Heresies, he says, now Matthew published also a book of the gospel among the Hebrews in their own dialect, while Peter and Paul were preaching the gospel in Rome and founding the church. This comes from Against Heresies, Book 3, Chapter 1, Section 2, which survives to us only in the Latin, the whole of the Against Heresies, but pieces are quoted here and there, and the Greek of Irenaeus is quoted in Eusebius' Church History, Book 5, Section 8, Chapter 2. Note that Irenaeus calls Matthew's work a gospel and puts it in the Hebrew dialect and gives it a date, while Peter and Paul were in Rome. We know that Paul was in Rome in the early 60s A.D., and so presumably that's the time period being referred to. A third witness to the authorship of Matthew is that of Pantinus, writing about the same time as Irenaeus, so around 180 A.D. We have his information only indirectly in Eusebius. Eusebius says in Church History, Chapter 5, Book 5, Chapter 10, Section 3, Pantinus also was one of them and is said to have gone to India, where the story goes that he found the gospel according to Matthew, which had preceded his arrival, among certain people there who had learned of Christ, that Bartholomew, one of the apostles, had preached to them, and that he had left the writing of Matthew in Hebrew letters, which also was preserved to the time indicated. Pantinus was a Christian from Alexandria, Egypt, who was head of the catechetical school there, ahead of Clement and Origen. Notice this is an indirect information. The story goes that, so it's, don't know what to make of that, but not nearly as strong as the others, huh? Pantinus notes that Matthew is written in Hebrew letters. That could still be Aramaic or Hebrew, but couldn't very well be Greek. The text is said to have been preserved still as of the late 2nd century. The remark about India is not far-fetched, as there was travel between India and the Roman world at this time. Our fourth testimony in this regard is Clement of Alexandria, and he's writing about 20 years later, around 200 AD. Clement was head of the catechetical school after Pantinus. The catechetical school doesn't tell you a whole lot about what this organization was, but we don't have a exactly equivalent term. Catechetical school sounds like a Sunday school class in a church. Well, it was kind of partly that, but it was also what we might even call a seminary. So it really covered a whole range of studies for Christians from early, from new converts up to fairly advanced. Clement of Alexandria said was head of his catechetical school after Pantinus. He left Alexandria during the persecution in 203 and then died sometime between 210 and 217 AD. Here's Clement's quote. This again is a citation by Eusebius. Again in the same books, and he's referring to Clement's outlines, Clement gives a tradition of the early presbyters concerning the order of the Gospels in the following manner. He said that those Gospels which contained the genealogies were written first, but the Gospel according to Mark had this occasion. So what do we got there? Well, we've got the tradition of the presbyters. So Clement means that the information he has comes from leaders ahead of his time. So that would presumably go back to, say, Pantinus or so, or maybe earlier than that. He explicitly states that Matthew and Luke were written first, so even before Mark. That's going to be actually the suggested order we wind up with here when we pull everything together. A fifth witness regarding the Gospel of Matthew is Origen, and he is overlaps Clement very slightly, but is writing here perhaps around 240 AD, so a full generation afterwards. Origen was Clement's successor in Egypt. He later went to Caesarea after some disagreements with the officials in the church in Alexandria. And there he built up a large library, which we think was the largest Christian library in antiquity, which was eventually inherited by Eusebius, and so became the basis for a great deal of his material on church history. In Origen's commentary on Matthew, Origen says this, this is Eusebius citing Origen, so he's that's third person. In the first of the books on the Gospel according to Matthew, observing the ecclesiastical canon, he, that is Origen, testifies that he knows only four Gospels, writing somewhat as follows. As he has learned by tradition concerning the four Gospels, which alone are undisputed in the Church of God under heaven, that first there was written a Gospel according to Matthew, the one-time publican, but afterwards an apostle of Jesus Christ, who published it in the Hebrew language, and here uses Gromason letters, for those from Judaism who believed. We'll come back and quote more of Origen's statements when we get to Mark, Luke, and John, etc. Question about the order here. Is Origen giving chronological order here? It's the first of the books, says Eusebius, quoting, observing the ecclesiastical canon. So is this first written chronologically or first written in canonical order? I don't know. Language there translated is letter, as I said, Gromason. And this is somewhat clearer than saying dialect. Well, that's the five earliest writers, if you like. The next two witnesses are important more for their access to written documents, which have not survived to today, than they are likely to have access to reliable oral tradition already by Origen. We're out 200 years after the ministry of Jesus. Eusebius is the major historian of the ancient church, and Jerome, one of its best scholars. So the sixth testimony here is from Eusebius of Caesarea, writing about 325, so we're now about 300 years out from ministry of Jesus. Eusebius here was bishop of Caesarea. You remember that's over on the Palestine coast. And but this is after the end of the Roman persecution, so this had not been a Jewish territory for a long time now. But he had access to the Library of Origen. Eusebius says in his church history, book 3, section 24, chapters 5 and 6, chapter 24, section 5 and 6, yet of all the disciples of the Lord, only Matthew and John have left us memoirs. And they, it is reported, had recourse to writing only under the pressure of necessity. For Matthew, who preached earlier to Hebrews, when he was about to go to others also, committed his gospel to writing in his native tongue, compensated by his writing for the lack of the loss of his presence to those from whom he went away. One interesting comment in here is the use of term memoirs. Only of the disciples, only Matthew and John left us memoirs. That's an ancient genre, a genre for famous people thinking back over events in their own lives and writing them up. Matthew and John, he says, according to his quotation here, had not planned to write, but when they saw the need arise, that as they were leaving Palestine, they did so. Now we move to Jerome, and he's writing another couple generations after Eusebius, about 400, in his Lives of Illustrious Men. Matthew is the fifth of the illustrious men, so this is in Lives of Illustrious Men 5. Matthew, who is also called Levi, and who changed from a publican, tax collector, to an apostle, was the first one in Judea to write a gospel of Christ in Hebrew letters and words for those from the circumcision who believed. Who translated afterwards into Greek is not sufficiently certain. So, that's a kind of quick tour of seven testimonies, and we have no contradictory testimony to these from antiquity. And they allow us to give this summary on the authorship of Matthew. First, that Matthew wrote the gospel ascribed to him is the unanimous opinion of tradition and, but perhaps not independently, of the titles on the extant manuscripts. This is consistent with the title and content of the first gospel. No other names are associated with it. The early church knew of fake gospels and rejected them. Secondly, that Matthew's gospel was the first written is also given several times in the tradition. This is frequently disputed today, as most liberals and many conservatives think Matthew's gospel uses Mark. Third, that Matthew's gospel was written in Hebrew, or perhaps Aramaic, is a regular feature of the tradition. This, too, is often disputed today, because the extant Greek gospel does not look like translation Greek from a Semitic language. By translation Greek, we mean a translation in which a lot of the Hebrew syntax and vocabulary range is carried over into Greek. The Septuagint, for example, is translation Greek in much of its text, though it varies from book to book in that regard. It, of course, could be that the translation tried to give it a more fluent Greek style. Some of the Old Testament translations into Greek were concerned about style. For instance, Symmachus and Theodotion used a good Greek style, whereas Aquila gave very literal translation Greek, even more so than the Septuagint, which is kind of intermediate between those. If we try to think of English examples, the NASB is something like translation English, and of course the English of an interlinear is even more like translation English. Whereas the NIV or such has perhaps a good English style. Who made the translation? Well, we don't know. Perhaps Matthew made a free translation at a later time. we don't know for sure if it was a translation. Well, though I think the testimony we've looked at points that way, nor if it is, who made it. What effect on inspiration would it have if Matthew, as we have it, was a translation? Well, of course, no problem. If Matthew translated it, would perhaps be more concerned if it was done by somebody besides an apostle, or somebody besides an apostle or a trusted associate. After all, Mark and Luke are responsible for two of the Gospels. However, the Church has been without the Bible in the original language for long periods in Church history. The Western Church had only Latin through the Middle Ages, and even today most Americans don't know the biblical languages at all. So most Christians, probably through most of history, have not had the Bible in the original languages. What languages were used in Palestine at New Testament times? Well, Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek were all used in the Bar Kokhba materials. You remember Bar Kokhba is the one who led the rebellion 132 to 135 AD in our Jewish backgrounds. And there were Bar Kokhba materials which have been found recently in some of the caves there in Israel. Latin, Greek, and Hebrew or Aramaic were used in the sign over the cross. We don't know how many people were multilingual. Since several of Jesus' New Testament statements are in transliterated Aramaic, Lama Lama Eli Eli Lama Sabachthani, and Talita Kum, and such, this was probably Jesus' native language. Well, that's a fast tour of the authorship of Matthew. Look secondly at Mark's authorship. Internal evidence, like Matthew, except for the book title, Mark is anonymous in its text. Some have suggested that the style seems to fit the personality of Peter, and we'll see in a moment there's a tradition that Peter is a source of Mark's gospel. Yes, I think it was Westcott suggested that style of Peter is impressionable rather than reflective, emotional rather than logical, and gives many details, including Jesus' emotions and looks and gestures, Peter's own thoughts, and this would suggest a close contact with Peter. But Luke 9:33 also gives Peter's response at the Transfiguration, so that's not quite unique to the Gospel of Mark. The outline of Mark is close to that of Peter's talk at Cornelius' house in Acts 10. Both start with John's baptism rather than with Jesus' birth or preexistence like the other Gospels. The standpoint of the narrative of Mark is consistent with Peter as author. What do we mean by the standpoint of a narrative? Well, we don't mean that the author refers to himself in the first person, rather that he structures the narrative so that a reader tends to identify with him or his group. And we see that rather like the way the birth narratives in Matthew and Luke seem to be written from Joseph's or Mary's viewpoint. To take a modern sample, if you've read the Harry Potter series, with only a few exceptions, they're all written from the standpoint of Harry. That is, the reader knows what Harry knows, but doesn't know what Dumbledore knows or what any of the other characters, Hermione knows or something of that sort, unless they say something to Harry, and then the reader knows it. So that would be kind of what's going on in that direction. For example, if we compare Mark 5:37 and Luke 9:23, raising Jesus' daughter, Matthew tells little of what happened in the house. Mark gives much more detail, gives the age of the girl, Jesus' remark to give her some food, and the people put out of the room. This is consistent with the idea that Matthew remained outside, got a few details later, while Peter went in and saw all the action, which is in fact what we're told happened. Another item that might that we could probably put under external evidence that might relate to authorship is Mark 14:51, the young man who loses his sheet at the arrest of Jesus. That makes the best sense as a brief sketch of Mark himself, pretty much like how Lost that thought. I'll come back to it if it comes up again. makes best sense as a brief sketch of Mark himself. Otherwise, it's strange to introduce someone with no explanation, especially when they have no connection with the narrative. I always think of Alfred Hitchcock movies. That's what I was thinking of. I couldn't come up with Alfred Hitchcock, where he always has a little vignette of himself stuck in the movie somewhere. You're inside a store or something, and there's a kind of a pan across to the front window, and here's this guy looking in the window, and then he wanders away or something like that. Would be an example of what we perhaps have in mind here. So that's the internal evidence regarding Mark and authorship. Looks like it might be reflect Peter's personality, and then maybe this little sketch might be Mark himself. External evidence for the authorship of Mark. We've got an even more extensive statement by Papias than we did for Matthew. Papias, remember, is writing about 130 A.D., and he says this, "And this the presbyter used to say. Mark, indeed, since he was the interpreter of Peter, wrote accurately but not in order the things either said or done by the Lord as much as he remembered. For he heard neither heard the Lord nor followed him, but afterwards, as I've said, Peter, who fitted his discourses to the needs of his hearers, but not as if making a narrative of the Lord's sayings. Consequently, Mark, writing some things just as he remembered, erred in nothing, for he was careful of one thing, not to omit anything of the things he had heard, nor to falsify anything in them." That's Expositions of Oracles of the Lord, here cited in Eusebius, Church History, Book 3, Chapter 39, Section 15. This is the most complete statement from Papias regarding any gospel. The brackets I have in my printed text here, I have after Presbyter, Apostle John, question mark, and the things either said or done by the Lord as much as he, and in brackets, Peter, Mark, remembered, etc., where we go, are either explanatory material added by the translators to clarify statements, or they are my comments. Papias is citing information which goes back before him. The presbyter, elder, is most likely the author of 2nd and 3rd John, who calls himself the elder. There's some argument over who that is, but my guess is it's the Apostle John. Irenaeus does note that Papias had studied under the Apostle John. There's a problem here of where the quotation from the elder ends and where the comment of Papias picks up, but my suggestion is it goes here, not in order, the things either said or done by the Lord as much as he remembered, and then we begin to get, after that point, not the elder's statement, which Papias remembered, but now Papias' explanation, for he neither heard the Lord nor followed him, but afterwards, as I've said, heard and followed Peter, etc. suggests, I think that's a good suggestion for the break, because the next sentence, as I say, is in the first person. Mark is here called the interpreter of Peter, and that might refer to a language which Peter did not know. Peter probably knew Greek, as he wrote 1st and 2nd Peter, but perhaps Mark translated into Latin. However, Mark could be called an interpreter of Peter just because he wrote Peter's memoirs for him, so that could be straightforward. The phrase accurately but not in order is a little strange, since many feel that the chronology or order of events in Mark is quite good. This might, however, refer to Mark's original note-taking, that is, Peter did not give the data in chronological order, but rather, as Papias himself said here, fitted it to the needs of his hearers, as he gave the messages in various Christian churches. In this case, Mark's compilation is in order, but the data given to him by Peter is not in order. How about as much as he remembered? That probably also refers to Peter, but not to Mark. Accurate first occurrence is within the direct quote from the elder, we suggested John. probably Papias is following what we might think of as rabbinic usage here. The student memorizes exactly a teacher's statement, the Mishnah, we might say, and then gives an explanation of that statement, the Gemara. So the quotation up there before our asterisk, which would read this way, Mark, indeed, since he was the interpreter of Peter, wrote accurately, but not in order, the things either said or done by the Lord as much as he remembered. That would be the elder's statement, and then the remarks after that would be Papias' explanation. Well, that's our first testimony regarding Mark. The second comes from a source that we didn't mention in connection with Matthew, and that's Justin Martyr. He is writing just 10 or 20 years after Papias, so 140 to 150. And we have two works preserved from him, his dialogue with Trypho, which took place apparently shortly after the Bar Kokhba War, so perhaps 140, and then his first apology, which might be rather later than that. After speaking several times in the dialogue with Trypho of the Memoirs of the Apostles called Gospels, and having just mentioned Peter, Justin said, it is written in his memoirs that he changed Peter's name as well as the sons of Zebedee, Boanerges. Well, if you look up Boanerges, you'll realize it's an allusion to Mark 3, verses 16-17, occurs nowhere else. And so the natural reading of it is, it's written in Peter's memoirs that he, Christ, changed Peter's name, as well as the names of the son of Zebedee, Boanerges. The assumption that his memoirs refers to Peter as author, and not to Christ, is, I think, reasonable, because Justin never refers to them as Christ's memoirs, but always to the memoirs of the apostles. A third testimony regarding Mark is Irenaeus, writing now about a generation after Justin Martyr, 180 AD. And we've already looked at the beginning of this statement, but I'll pick that up again. Matthew published while Peter and Paul were preaching the gospel in Rome and founding the church. After their departure, Mark, the disciple and interpreter of Peter, also handed this down to us in writing the things preached by Peter. The ambiguous element in this particular quotation is the word departure. It's exodos, okay? And exodos is used rather commonly in Greek for two different things, physical departure and as a euphemism for departure from this life. So is Irenaeus speaking of after the death of Peter and Paul, or after they left Rome? And as I say, both of those constructions are common, so we'll not get the answer to that by just looking in a lexicon, if you like. Fourth testimony is from Clement of Alexandria, we're looking at the same citation of Clement and outlines that we looked at a little bit earlier, where he said the Gospels with the genealogies were written first. And then he goes on to say, in that sentence, the gospel according to Mark had this occasion. When Peter had preached the word publicly in Rome and had declared the gospel by that spirit, those who were present, there were many, besought Mark, since he had followed him for a long time and remembered the things that had been spoken, to write out the things that had been said. And when he had done this, he gave the gospel to those who asked him. When Peter learned of it later, he neither obstructed nor commended it. That's outlines cited in Eusebius Church History, Book 6, Section 14, Chapter 14, Section 5. Note that in this citation by Clement, Peter's still alive when the gospel is written, because he reacts to it afterwards. Peter's not sure what to do with the writing. His puzzlement somewhat resembles that he experienced when the Holy Spirit fell on the Gentiles at Cornelius' house, not to mention the time when Jesus was transfigured with Elijah and Moses, and he wasn't quite sure what to do, was suggesting building some tabernacles or something. Peter, as you recall, is one who is fast with the mouth and not always fast with thinking it through. Outspoken, I think we call that. Fifth testimony is from Tertullian. Tertullian is in the Latin part of the Roman Empire, North Africa, and he's writing around 200 AD. He says in his work Against Marcion, chapter 4, book 2, book 4, chapter 2, or chapter 4, section 2. So then, if apostles, John and Matthew, instill us with faith, of apostolic men, Luke and Mark, renew it. Is Tertullian referring to the order of writing here? Well, I doubt it. I suspect he's only has in mind, you might say, the strength of the witnesses regarding their proximity to Jesus. So, apostles, people who spent 3 years with Jesus, John and Matthew, apostolic men, people who spent years with apostles, Luke and Mark. I think that's probably what he's saying there. Origen, writing about 225 A.D., we'd already seen first the Gospel of Matthew was written, etc. This continues on in that same sentence. And that secondly, there was written a Gospel according to Mark, who made it as Peter instructed him, whom also he, that is Peter, acknowledges the Son in the Catholic epistles in these words, saying, "The church in Babylon elect together with you, and Mark, my son, salute you," quotation at 1 Peter 5:13. Well, secondly, Mark would most naturally refer to chronological order, but perhaps in the context only to canonical order. Remember, there was a remark about according to the ecclesiastical canon back in the previous sentence. Summary on authorship. First, that Mark wrote the gospel ascribed to him is unanimous opinion of tradition, as is the belief that it gives us Peter's preaching. Mark's authorship is supported by extant manuscript titles. There is less argument over Matthew's authorship, over Mark's authorship compared to Matthew's or John. There is, however, considerably more resistance in liberal circles to the idea that he gives us Peter's preaching. Secondly, these traditions are consistent with the nature of the gospel itself in a somewhat stronger and more obvious way than was the case for Matthew. The linkage to Peter is not explicit in the manuscripts, but is consistent with the tone of the gospel, as seen above under our internal evidence, and also that little vignette of 1451 and 52. Thirdly, some see a contradiction in the tradition regarding the date of Mark and the time of writing relative to Luke. Irenaeus is interpreted as saying that Mark wrote after Peter's death, whereas Clement of Alexandria clearly implies that Mark wrote before his death. Contradiction, however, is not necessary here, as Irenaeus may be referring to Peter and Paul leaving Rome alive, literal Exodus, rather than to their death, figurative Exodus. It appears that Paul, at least, did leave Rome after his first imprisonment, according to Acts 28 and tradition. Another alleged contradiction relates to the relative order of Mark and Luke. Many traditions give the order Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, but Clement says that the Gospels with the genealogies, Matthew, Luke, were written first. So we'd have something like Matthew, Luke, then Mark, John. We'll need to come back and think about that when we look at the date of the Gospels. That brings us to consider Luke's authorship, and again, internal and external evidence. Well, internal evidence, except for its title, the gospel text is anonymous. However, the prologue of Acts links Acts to Luke, and internal features in Acts suggest the author of Acts was a companion of Paul, either Luke or Jesus Justus, by trying just to eliminate people who are or aren't around at the right times. The prologues of Luke and Acts both mention Theophilus. Acts prologue refers to a previous account, which is clearly the gospel we call Luke. Also related to internal evidence, the vocabularies of Luke and Acts are similar and indicate a well-educated author with an unusual knowledge of medical terms. The classic work on this is William Kirk Hobart, The Medical Language of St. Luke, where this evidence is organized and presented for you. Well, that's the internal evidence on Luke's authorship. External evidence. We have fewer early references to Luke than we do for Matthew and Mark. Perhaps no one saw fit to report Papias' comments on this gospel, if he made any, since we don't have Papias in its entirety, but only the scattered quotations. We really don't know. The earliest source we have, actually two of them about tied for earliest, is what we call a Muratorian canon, written apparently late in the 2nd century, so say 180 approximately, and written apparently from Italy. Muratorian canon is a list of books belonging to the New Testament, that's why it's called canon, that was a term used for a list at that time, but named for its discoverer, Muratori, in 1740, rather than for its author. The discovered piece is a fragment with the end and the beginning missing in the manuscript we've got, and possible evidence that some of the middle was missing in one of its ancestors. We cannot tell that here. It survives in a single 8th century manuscript, which one scholar describes written in barbarous Latin by a careless and ignorant scribe. I'm not qualified to answer those, respond to those sort of things. It's clearly a translation of a Greek original. That is, it's in Latin translation Greek, okay? translation Latin, I guess is what we call that. And from internal evidence, it dates back to the late 2nd century, was written in or near Rome, which it calls the city. It refers to one of the early popes as in our own times, so suggests that the author's life overlaps with him. It's I think it's Pius, early second century pope, and it refers to Hermas as the brother of Pius, who was apparently bishop of Rome in the author's own lifetime. There we go. I found that in the notes now. The canon starts out this way, but he was present among them, and so he put. The third book of the Gospel is that according to Luke. Luke, the physician, after the ascension of Christ, when Paul had taken him with him as a companion of his traveling, after he'd made an investigation, wrote in his own name, but neither did he see the Lord in the flesh, and thus as he was able to investigate, so also he begins to tell the story from the nativity of John. As only Luke begins with the birth of John the Baptist, the correct gospel is in view. No other known gospel, including apocryphal ones, begins with John's nativity. Remark about traveling companion fits with the testimony of Acts. So that's the Muratorian canon. Second, Irenaeus, from around the same time. Muratorian canon, we think, from Italy somewhere. Irenaeus, writing from France, but grew up in Asia Minor, and we'll jump into his sentence again, which we had already looked at. Now, Matthew published while Peter and Paul were preaching gospel in Rome and founding the church. After their departure, Mark, the disciple interpreter Peter, handed down to us in writings the things preached by Peter. Luke also, the follower of Paul, put down in a book the gospel preached by that one, and then afterwards John. So that's what Irenaeus has to say there. Irenaeus seems to be giving the general chronological order of writing, although there's one little interesting quirk in it. He puts Luke third, but he doesn't quite say that Luke is written third. So, after their departure, Peter and Paul's departure, Mark handed down to us, right, etc., and then Luke also put down in a book, and then afterwards John. So, Mark is clearly put after Matthew, and John is put after Luke, but Luke is just put Luke also. So it might be intended chronological, which is certainly reasonable, but it doesn't quite say so. Third testimony, Clement of Alexandria, writing here about 208 from Egypt. And this is Eusebius again. Again, in the same books, Clement gives a tradition of the early presbyters concerning the order of the Gospels in the following manner. He said those of the Gospels which contained the genealogies were written first, but the Gospel according to Mark had this occasion. So notice that the chronological order of Clement seems different than Irenaeus in that Luke precedes Mark. So, two last testimonies regarding Luke. Tertullian, writing about 215 from North Africa, that same quote we had before. So then of apostles, John and Matthew instill us with faith, apostolic men Luke and Mark renew it. For Luke's gospel, similarly men are used to ascribe to Paul. And then finally, Origen, writing about 225 from Egypt. Whoops, sorry, I've got another example after him. Just page split in my notes. Origen, writing from Egypt. And thirdly, that according to Luke, the gospel praised by Paul, who made it for those from the Gentiles who believed. The remark about the gospel praised by Paul is probably referring to 2 Corinthians 8:18, but most commentators doubt that this is what Paul had in mind, where he says, according to my gospel. Most writers today think he's referring to his message rather than referring to a written work about Jesus. Lastly, Eusebius, writing about 330, his church history, book 3, chapter 4, section 6 and 7. Luke, in regard to race being of those of Antioch, but by profession a physician, since he had been very much with Paul and had no mean association with the rest of the apostles, left us examples of the therapy of souls, which he acquired from them in two inspired books. The gospel, which he testifies that he also wrote according to what those handed down to him who were eyewitnesses from the beginning and ministers of the word, all of whom he also says had followed even from the beginning. He had followed even from the beginning. And the Acts of the Apostles, which he composed from what he had learned, not by hearing, but with his eyes. But men say that Paul was accustomed to refer to his gospel whenever writing, as it were, about some gospel of his own. He said, according to my gospel. Eusebius may be drawing inferences from New Testament passages, as my gospel probably refers to Paul's message. Many of Paul's references to my gospel probably predate the writing of Luke. Well, that's our quick tour there. Summary on authorship here. That Luke, a follower of Paul and a physician, wrote the gospel ascribed to him as unanimous opinion of tradition, though we have no remarks quite so early as those of Papias from Matthew and Mark. By 200 AD, we have information from all of the geographical areas of the early Christianity agreeing that Luke is the author. This implies that the title has been on the work a long time, or that early Christians had access to common knowledge. That the author was a physician who traveled with Paul is consistent with the internal vocabulary of the third gospel and with its linkage to Acts. Thus, based on internal evidence, Luke is most likely to be the author. The gospel is frequently mentioned third, perhaps preserving a tradition regarding the order of authorship. Alternatively, this could be an early binding or canon order. The Maturian canon, Irenaeus, and Origen all cite Luke as third. If Luke is really written third and after Paul's death, then Clement is in error and some internal problems developed regarding the date of Acts. So we turn to consider the date of these Gospels. So we've looked at the authorship, and it's interesting, I think, in retrospect, to point out that we have no titles on any of the surviving manuscripts that give any other authors. And you ask yourself, would these be the authors that people would naturally have gravitated to? And I think the answer would be, well, John maybe, but Mark and Luke not. And Matthew, not a major character among the apostles. This is really the major thing he's noted for. So my suggestion is this really does go back to real knowledge, and that's seen in the lack of disagreement on these things. Let's look at the date of the Synoptic Gospels, and we'll do again date of Matthew's Gospel, date of Mark's Gospel, date of Luke's Gospel. And we're going to look at internal evidence and external evidence. So, date of Matthew's Gospel, internal evidence. Internal evidence is of very little help here. Two remarks suggest that the gospel was not written immediately after the resurrection, like in the 30s, and that is Matthew 28:8. The place is called the Field of Blood to this day. Okay, suggests there's some space between the event in which Judas hung himself and the event of the writing of the gospel. And then Matthew 28:15 regarding the claim of the soldiers that the body was stolen. This story is widely spread among the Jews to this day. So both imply a significant time interval between the event and the writing, but they don't say how much. Liberals tend to date Matthew after 70 AD, partly to place it after Mark, which they date just before 70, and partly to post-date Jesus' predictions. We have in Matthew 21:41 the parable of the tenant farmers who kill the son, which implies the destruction of the nation, Israel, for killing Jesus. And so after 70 AD, the story being made up to fit what happened. But of course, if Jesus knows the future, that's not really a strong argument. And then Matthew 22:7, in the wedding banquet, the Jews refused to come beat on his servants. So the king destroyed those murderers and set their city on fire. Fits Jerusalem, so written after 70 is their argument, huh? And then Matthew 23:38, your house is being left to you desolate. Either Jerusalem, their house, or the temple, their house, destroyed, so after 70. And then Matthew 24, the Olivet Discourse describes the fall of Jerusalem, so written afterwards. Liberals say Mark could be written just before the fall of Jerusalem, since that gospel does not include these details as clearly. Obviously, this is no problem for believers, since all of these are in prediction contexts, and Jesus can predict the future. External evidence on the date of Matthew. Well, Matthew is obviously written before the earliest surviving manuscripts. The papyri P64 and P67, which are actually the same papyrus, but got numbered differently before it was realized by looking at the manuscripts that they were the same. And P77 represent two manuscripts from about 200 AD. So the gospel was written before 200. Well, probably nobody's denied that except a few early atheists who felt that it was all written by monks in the Middle Ages. The Epistle of Barnabas, probably written around 132 AD, cites Matthew 22:14, many called but few chosen, by saying, as the scripture says, but it doesn't name Matthew. Liberals say Matthew was written by then, but Pseudo-Barnabas misremembered the quote as an Old Testament scripture. My spot would be that Barnabas, like Christians at the time, viewed Matthew as scripture. Traditionally, authorship would require that it be written within Matthew's lifetime. We don't know how long he lived. Probably no later than 100 AD. The information we do have from tradition is that John outlived everybody else, and that he lived just under the time of Trajan, I guess it is. Trajan, yeah. So generally is given as around 100 AD. So Matthew probably died no later than 100, probably much earlier. This is obviously limited by Matthew's age. Since Matthew was an adult with some authority, he was a tax collector, by about 30 AD, it's presumed that he was probably at least 30 and maybe older than that in 30 AD, so doubtful he was living after 100. Thus, the traditions imply that Matthew was written in the first century. Allusions in other apostolic fathers, including Clement, about 95 AD, would agree with this. Irenaeus's tradition would date it 61 to 68 AD, while Peter and Paul were in Rome preaching the gospel. Several other traditions make Matthew's gospel the first one written, so it might conceivably be even earlier. Luke, as we'll suggest below, was probably written in the late 50s, so Matthew's date would thus be somewhat earlier than that. Some various proposals for Matthew's date. These range from AD 37, and whoever made the note in the Old Schofield Reference Bible, to 125 AD is the latest I've run into by my teacher Robert Kraft, a liberal at the University of Pennsylvania. 37 is probably too early for the to this day references. 125 AD seems to me far too skeptical of historical sources. Doesn't explain why Christians and even heretics accepted it and used only the four Gospels. My suggestion for the date looked like this. It's got some speculation to it, and that is that Irenaeus is slightly mistaken on the Peter and Paul thing and suggests that Matthew wrote a Hebrew Gospel in the 40s or perhaps early 50s before he left Jerusalem. Note, when Paul visits Jerusalem, he found only Peter and John there. Matthew later made a Greek edition in the 60s for wider use. Thus, Irenaeus is correct about author and language, but mistakes its publication in Greek for its original Hebrew composition. No way to prove that. That's a proposal. Papias' statement implies that for some time Matthew was the only written gospel available and was in demand even in its Hebrew form, as apparently no Greek translations had been made yet, and that seemed to me to fit that. This model is proposed to fit the tradition of Matthew being the first gospel written with to the evidence of pre-60 date of Luke. We'll come back to that when we get to the date of Luke. Into Mark's gospel. Internal evidence. Nothing direct. Liberals like to date by post-dating predictions, so they tend to put it late. A solution to the synoptic problem is going to have a bearing here, depending on whether we see Mark as written before or after Matthew and Luke. External evidence. See the various fathers that we cited above. Based on account of surviving manuscripts and citations by church fathers, Mark was considerably less popular than Matthew in the early church. And that's of some interest, given particularly that it's got the tradition that Peter is the source behind it. Would probably make best sense if Matthew had already been circulating for a while. There are several dating schemes for Mark. There's first of all what we might call the concordant dating scheme, that is, conflict minimizing scheme. That interprets the testimony of the church fathers in such a way as to put the date of Mark in the 60s before the death of Peter. You remember, Clement dates the gospel during Peter's lifetime. Irenaeus is referring to Peter leaving Rome and not to his death in this type of interpretation. So Exodus, Peter is in Rome, but then leaves Rome for some reason. In that sense, then, we can date Mark between Paul's arrival in Rome, narrated in Acts, and looks like about 61 to 63 AD, and 68 AD, when the persecution ended with Nero's death. Some scholars, on the other hand, reject Clement of Alexandria's testimony and interpret Irenaeus' Exodus remark so as to date the gospel after the death of Peter. This is a common liberal view, with Mark dead after 68, perhaps into the early, with Mark dated after 68, perhaps in the early 70s. Some extreme liberals date Mark as late as 115 AD. Thirdly, many conservatives reject old tradition and put Mark back in the 50s so that Mark can predate Matthew and Luke. This view throws out a lot of data in order to maintain a conservative version of the two-document theory. This will be discussed later under our topic, the synoptic problem. Summary on the date of Mark. Clearly, people are willing to ignore data so that their view of the synoptic problem to be discussed looks plausible. The concordant view seems to fit the data best, and that's favored by me. However, it must reject the two-document theory, which puts Mark earlier than Matthew. That brings us to the date of Luke's gospel. Internal evidence. Well, you can argue whether this is internal evidence or not, but clearly Acts 1:1 presupposes Luke, so the gospel must be written before Acts. The prologues are connected, since Acts refers to the previous account. Luke ends with the ascension. Acts picks up from there and continues. Both are addressed to the same person, Theophilus. Liberals feel that Luke 21:20 refers to the Jewish war, so they date Luke after AD 70. As predicted in Luke 21:20, in 66 AD, the city was surrounded by armies, but the Roman general got scared and retreated. This allowed people to flee the city, as Jesus had warned them to do, and lots of Christians did, before the Romans came back the second time in 68 AD and leveled Jerusalem, as in verse 24. Only unbelievers feel a need to post-date prophecies. No such approach is warranted for believers, though of course Luke could have written after AD 70 if other evidence so indicates. That is, it's not necessary that Luke write before the prophecy was fulfilled. That's all we can say on internal evidence. External evidence, Acts, as we discuss in our course, Acts and Pauline Epistles, seems to date from the end of Paul's first Roman imprisonment around 63 to 64 AD. and that's because the date of Acts seems to precede the Roman fire, Acts 64, as it reflects no antagonism between Christianity and the Roman government. And once Nero passed, put the blame for the fire on Christians, Christianity became an illegal cult until after 300 AD. Acts gives us no hint that Christianity is illegal. Acts also gives us no hint of the death of Paul, and that is also, according to tradition, while Nero is still alive, so no later than about 68 AD. Paul has been in Rome for 2 years under house arrest when the book of Acts ends. Liberals, to try and explain this away, say everyone knows what happened to Paul, so there was no need to include his death. But house arrest is a strange way to end a book if he's dead. Some, including some conservatives, suggest Luke intended to write a third book as a sequel to Acts, but for some reason never was able to do so. This argument is based on taking Acts 1:1, the first account I wrote, etc., where it uses proton for first, to mean the first of several, and assuming Luke would have used proteron if he meant the first of two. Well, the word used in Acts 1:1 can mean first of two in Hellenistic Greek, even though this was not proper in classical Greek. And we have no particular reason to believe that Luke is writing in classical Greek in general, even though his Greek is somewhat nicer than some other Greek writers of the period. If our suggestion is right, Luke brings the reader up to date at the end of Acts. That is, he is writing just 2 years after Paul has arrived in Rome. Secondly, that Luke would be dated slightly earlier than Acts is seen from internal evidence above, especially if Paul's two-year imprisonment in Caesarea, that's before his trip and shipwreck headed for Rome, especially if Paul's two-year imprisonment in Caesarea gave Luke the opportunity for researching and writing the gospel. Now, if Luke wrote the gospel before the voyage to Rome, that would avoid the problem with Luke losing his notes if in the shipwreck. And of course, he might have saved them even so. In this case, Luke would begin to circulate in the East about the time of Paul's voyage around 60, and perhaps not begin to circulate in the West until substantially later. A date of about 60 AD seems to buck the tradition that puts Mark in the 60s but earlier than Luke. I suggest that either the tradition is partly mistaken, or that both Mark and Luke are nearly simultaneous and reach different parts of the empire at different times. That Mark arrived first in some places, say the West, and Luke arrived first in others, say the East. Mark is traditionally written in Rome, the West. Clement, in Egypt, the East, puts Luke ahead of Mark chronologically. Irenaeus' testimony looks chronological, but note, and he's the one who says also Luke also, and puts it after Mark and before John, but note that he does not give an explicit time or sequence reference for Luke. He doesn't say afterward. Irenaeus may not be intending to be chronological here, or he may be mistaken because the sources receive the two Gospels in a different order than Egypt did. Then we date Luke 58 to 60 AD before Acts in 63 to 64 AD. So, a summary on the dates of the Synoptic Gospels. My notes here have a little chart, but I give a big, broad span for Matthew from perhaps as early as the early 40s to something like the mid-50s, Luke, the late 50s, and Mark, the middle 60s, or early to middle 60s. Well, I think that's probably a good place to stop.
This is Dr. Robert C. Newman in his Synoptic Gospels course, lecture number 4, on the authorship and date of the Synoptic Gospels.